Tonight's special guest is Kerry Spackman. Kerry is the writer of a fascinating new book called The Ant and the Ferrari, lifting the hood on truth, society, and the universe. The Ant and the Ferrari offers readers a clear, navigable path through the big questions that confront us all today. We welcome Kerry Spackman as our special guest on The Beat Goes On. Welcome to The Beat Goes On, Kerry Spackman.
Wonderful to be here.
Wow, we're honored to have the author of The Ant and the Ferrari. Wonderful title, too. Did you lie awake at night, Kerry, thinking, what's a wonderful name to catch people's attention? Where did that come from, The Ant and the Ferrari?
Well, it was a sort of a metaphor that I've thought about for a long time. So the title actually came from the image itself. So for me, I imagine, imagine if your audience in their mind sees this little ant crawling across this lake of red.
Yes, exactly.
And in your mind, you zoom out and you see the little legs scratching on the shiny surface. And then as you zoom out bigger and bigger, you realize that the ant is actually walking on the bonnet of a Ferrari. Mm. And you think to yourself, the ant has no concept that it's walking on a car. It has no idea that there is even an engine under the bonnet. And so the question which has always fascinated me ever since I was a little boy is, are we just like ants crawling on the bonnet of the universe,
trying to work it out,
blissfully unaware of everything underneath it? And for me, the exciting thing is there a way to lift the hood, to see under there, to see all that complexity and to actually make life richer? So rather than just being a plain, bland surface, we actually see the nuts and bolts. And that's fascinated me from a child. And the question, of course, is, how do you do that? We can answer questions now that Socrates and Plato agonized over. We can actually get definitive answers. Yes. And these are not just guesses, they are real answers. So for example, if you go back far enough, people used to think lightning was caused by Zeus throwing thunderbolts from heaven, because they didn't really understand. It was just way too complicated. But now we understand how electrons work, and we can make lightning in the spark plugs of our cars every day we drive to work. We can answer that particular question. And so I find it very interesting that some of the big questions, the origin of the universe, what is man's status in life, science is now able to answer some of those questions in very definitive ways where there's no doubt about it anymore. There's certain things we don't know, of course, but there are certain things that we can absolutely categorically rule out now. And it's very exciting.
Well, Kerry, that's all in the book, and have you done a magnificent job explaining it all. But first of all, a little about you. Our viewers are saying, who is this Kerry Spackman? How did he come to write this book? Well, first of all, you're a baby boomer, I hear.
I am a baby boomer, yes.
Wonderful. Can we have the date that you became a baby boomer?
I was born in 56.
1956.
So that goes back a long time.
Oh, you're a classic.
Yes,
a
I
classic
am.
Baby
yes.
boomer. And Kerry, you are a New Zealander, of course. A little bit of history about your New Zealand hood.
Yes, born in New Zealand, and I love the country, but I spent quite a bit of time in England in Formula One, but I decided I had enough of helping cars go around in circles faster.
Sure.
At the end of the day, it doesn't matter if Michael Schumacher wins or Fernando Alonso wins, the world's still the same.
Yeah.
So for me, I wanted to do something that was important. Plus, I love New Zealand. I've got my family back here.
Oh, it's okay. So you're living back in New Zealand.
Living back in New Zealand. I've been back here now for 3 years and loving it.
Leading on to you writing this book, Kerry, yeah. So what's you are a physicist, is that the exact term?
Not quite. A neuroscientist.
A neuroscientist.
Ooh. But also did mathematics as well, so an unusual character. Had many years in Formula One, involved in the sort of mathematics and analysis. But I've always been passionate about truth. Is there such a thing as truth, and can we ever know? Because I don't want to go through life playing by the wrong rules. You know, you wouldn't go into a casino and play bet all your life on blackjack if you didn't know the rules. And so the question is, are there rules? What are the rules we should play by? And can we ever know those? And so for me, that's been really important.
And what's important right from the beginning of the book, belief systems. Now, we've had a million belief systems since time began, and the one that we've got today is only one of those million, isn't it?
Yes.
Based on the Christian concepts.
I think for me, I start the book by saying, what actually is the nature of truth?
Yes.
Because unless we can agree on that, you could say, well, your truth is okay for you and my truth is good for me, and truths are all relative. Or maybe you could even say that science is just another belief system and it's just as valid as, say, you know, Christianity. So unless we can come to some sort of agreement between me as the writer and you as the reader as to a sensible way forward that we both agree is common ground, well, I might as well give up. So what I try to do is take the reader on a journey with me, and we say, well, is there anything such that is absolute, something that we can hang our hat on? And then how can we progress from there? And so for me, I draw up a thing which I call the compass of truth. And at the very top, I have things which I call absolutely true. I draw this compass, and then we try and test beliefs and see where they fit on that compass. And of course, probably your viewers will be saying, well, it's all very well having that compass, but is there such a thing as absolute truth at all? Is there anything at the top?
Yeah.
And the answer for me is, well, yes, of course. All of mathematics is absolutely true.
One and one equals two.
Yes, or if you take something like the theorem of Pythagoras that we use at school, you know, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. That's absolutely true for a, you know, perfect right angle triangle. It would be true even if the universe didn't exist. There are some things, pure logic and mathematics, which are absolutely true. Now the question is, can we attach things to those as we move around the compass that give us a lot of certainty or a lot of comfort that we are having beliefs which match reality?
But here we have millions of people around the world believe that Jesus Christ was born from a virgin. Now, you have 1 billion people in the world suspending their thought processes to go along with what we're talking about, a belief system.
So if you say to me, Jesus was born of a virgin because God can do anything he likes, well, I can't argue against that. That's fine. But if you tell me the Bible says in Genesis that the universe was created in 6 literal days of 24 hours, if you say that, and if you say that the earth came before the stars, I can test that, and I can tell you are absolutely categorically wrong.
Mm.
So at this stage, I start to cast doubt on the authority of that particular claim about the origin of the universe. And so for me, I really want to know what actually is, because I think beliefs are the most powerful things in the world.
Mm. Well, they go to wars over them, don't they? Thousands of people get killed with these belief systems.
Any belief that doesn't match reality is likely to have some sort of consequence down the line, even if it's not completely obvious at the time. So you can't just say, well, this belief may be wrong, but we're going to let it go because it doesn't seem to cause any damage. You know, the same argument would have been, you know, many years ago, there were many things we didn't think had any damage to us, but as we find out later on, they do. So I think if you don't look at truth very carefully all the way through, there's a cost.
The Arab pilots on the way to crash into the Twin Towers in New York, operating under their belief system, if you'd put this book in front of them and said, and it was written in Arabic, have a read of this before you crash into the... there's an old saying, you can cast pearls before swine, but you'll never get them to...
Well, that was the reason I wrote this book, is because there are so many books out there which are really good books that people read and are not moved by. They don't change their belief system because their belief system is so different to the belief system of the writer. And so I wanted to write a book that the average, no matter who you are and no matter what you believe, hopefully we can find some common ground and then we can start a journey together.
Yes.
And so I actually tested this book before I printed it. We produced, I forget how many, 90-something, maybe 100. I don't actually remember the exact number, but it's around 90 to 100. And we sent them out to as many different people as we could, Buddhists, fundamental Christians, missionaries, the whole range, surfer dudes who didn't care about anything. And I asked them only one thing, is that they would send back to me an anonymous survey, so I didn't know who they were, and just say, did any of this book change your view on life? And in that sample I had, and of course it's not a scientific sample, but in that sample, every single person said they changed their belief about something.
About something, yes.
About something. So for me, that's the key of the book.
In the book, Kerry, you've got two great chapters.
Only two.
No, you've got...
I'm just joking.
I mean, the big ones for everyone, and that is, is there life after death? I mean, that has to be the biggie. And you also, in chapter 18, talk about purpose and meaning. Is there a purpose and meaning in being alive?
Yes, a lot of people say, well, gosh, I have to have a God, because if there wasn't a God, there would be no design or no purpose. And if there's no purpose, well, I might as well give up living now. Mm. Or sometimes people have said to me, okay, you've convinced me you're right on whatever belief they were thinking about, but in my heart I don't want to believe it because I just feel I need a purpose in life. And so I devote an entire chapter to that. And there is no short answer, unfortunately, for the TV, but there isn't a short answer.
And we wouldn't try on this TV show. I mean, you have to buy the book, of course, to read what you say about the purpose of life. But I just want to commend you for going for the two biggies. You know, is there life after death, and what's the purpose of life? I mean, there is this yearning to have an existence after death. How can you explain that?
I think that is a very pervasive yearning, but I think when people get to a certain level of enlightenment, if I can call it that word, that yearning dissipates. You become at peace, genuinely at peace, with a limited, finite life. And I think it's not everybody has that yearning. I think, and it's not that you train yourself out of it, I think with enlightenment, you see the world differently. Because that's the thing you want to know. What is my purpose for being here? Can I have a designer life? Can I design my own life? And can, in that process of designing my own life, actually have genuine meaning, which is not superficial? And I think the answer is yes. And I think that's quite liberating, I think, actually. And it's not a trick. It's not like we're fooling ourselves into the fact that there is meaning in life. There genuinely is.
Dare I ask for a yes or no answer to both those questions? If I said, is there life after death, could you confidently say yes, or would you hesitate and say no?
My gut feeling would be, on my compass of truth, it's definitely, the answer's not at we absolutely know. No one's been to death and back again.
So we don't know.
So the answer is we don't know. Having said that, there is a preponderance of evidence, which I put in the book, which indicates that we can be fairly confident that probably this life for us, Kerry or Gerard, is all there is, and that once I shake this mortal coil, there is no more. And I produce a number of pieces of evidence in there to show that. But for me, that's not a scary factor. It just makes this life that much more vital.
More important, doesn't it?
Makes every day count, the carpe diem.
And is there a purpose and meaning to our lives? Yes or no?
Yes, absolutely.
There is.
Yep.
There is.
But I think, however, we need to construct that purpose ourselves. And I think that's part of this book. And I give a number of examples of different instruments and what the idea of a purpose means.
Now, I'm being unfair to you, Kerry, by asking you to answer those, because this whole chapter is devoted to exactly what you said. So it is not they really aren't yes or no questions, are they?
No.
So I really, but they are the two biggies, aren't they?
They are certainly big ones in there, yes.
When you finish this book, Kerry, I mean, it's a beauty. Did you think, wow, I've got a winner here? When you read it, you write it and then you're right into it, but then you'll proofread it yourself and you'll go, wow, this is great. So what was your feelings when you realised you've got a winner here?
Well, writing, of course, has been something that is relatively new to me. I really got into writing when I wrote The Winner's Bible, and that went to number one and is a huge, massive number one bestseller. And that was about being a champion and being a winner from my work in Formula One. However, that wasn't what I was passionate about. This has always been my passion. And this book took me a long time to write. I wrote this book probably 5 or 6 times because I wanted
honing
to get
it down, rewriting, tweaking.
Throwing chapters away entirely, rewriting the same chapter 18, 19 times because I really wanted to get this. So it was easy, it wasn't offensive, it took the audience on a journey, and it got the grandeur of the universe that we live in. And I really wanted, I cover everything from cosmology to quantum mechanics to evolution to economics. So it's a big, big book in many ways.
Every big question in the universe is in this.
Well, there was a famous quote, I think it was Oscar Wilde, who said, I was going to write you a short letter, but I ran out of time, so I wrote you a long one instead. And so the point is that it's very much harder to write a small beautifully put together book. So this took a lot of time and a lot of effort. It's had my soul in it.
What's the proudest moment you're going to have? Can I suggest that I'm sure if you saw a classroom of kids reading The Ant and the Ferrari, how would that make you feel?
That would be fantastic.
I mean, that's what it'd be all about, wouldn't it?
It is about changing lives, and that's important, but I didn't do it for myself. This will probably take too long in the interview, but there's a wonderful thing in history with a father gave his son a little compass to play with, and he just watched his five-year-old son play with a compass and thought nothing more of it. And it turned out that that little boy in 1905 playing with that compass changed your life, changed my life, changed the entire world, because that little boy happened to be Albert Einstein. And he wondered, how does a needle move when nothing touches it? Normally things move when you touch them, but the needle moved on his own. And so he was passionate about that. Right. The point of the story is that his dad never understood. He saw the compass and never realized the implications. And probably Einstein didn't realize that all your computers are a result of his work.
We're sitting here today with these television cameras and that, all because of
that little compass.
That little compass that was given to Einstein.
Yes, and so for me, maybe I don't have to see the outworkings of the book.
But you planted a seed.
I just want to plant a seed because I passionately want the world to be better.
Can we give away three books tonight, Kerry, and let our viewers know what a great book it is? And we need a very simple question. It doesn't have to be too complicated.
Why don't we keep it simple?
Yep.
What's the name of the book?
Wow. Here's the big clue. The Ant and the Ferrari. And that is what you put in the subject line, and you address the email to Jared@thebeatgoeson, and all the names will go into a draw, and we'll announce the winners next week. Now, Kerry, any plans for another book?
At the moment, I'm working really hard on a big movie.
On a movie? Oh, yeah. What's it called?
It's top secret. I'm sorry, but it covers these sorts of things in a Hollywood format. So it's a really big movie. It's a big blockbuster. And, of course, you know, you're talking sort of, you know, budgets of hundreds of millions. So I've got to keep everything under wraps until the end. But I'm nearly at the end of the first part of the...
You're doing the first draft, are you?
Yes, I am.
Or the second draft or the third draft?
Well, I've done seven drafts. I'm on my seventh draft now, but I think the magic seven, we're about there now. Yeah. And we've got a lot of interest around the world. So... Yes, this will be a really big movie.
Would you come back on the program once it's released and
absolutely.
Tell us all about it?
Yeah, no, oh, absolutely.
I'd love to see you.
Yeah, no, it's a great movie.
Kerry?
It's been great, Gerard. Wonderful.
Wonderful being an author and having great books.
Fantastic.
See you soon.
Good.